So very good evening, investors. One more webinar, one more interactive session. The man who's sitting next to me doesn't need much introduction to our investors, who has been giving a rocking performance, if I'm I can humbly say that. He's none other than Vinit Sambre, a senior fund manager from DSP BlackRock, who has been managing DSP BlackRock small and mid cap and micro cap. Needless to say, this fund has taken a woo, and in our system, investors have been behind this fund for the last 2-3 years very aggressively. I think the returns has been extremely good. So I'm not going to, the investors has been waiting to hear from you, Vinit, what exactly your views is. I'm not going to go scheme specific because that's not our agenda today. They are very keen to hear from the small cap and mid cap mogul like you to hear what's more happening in that space. You know, this I think the last 2-3 months has been a very interesting front in the market. Needless to say, your smile says it all. So as an investor, you know, all our retail investors, we from HDFC Securities has been doing this interactive session with the renowned fund managers to hear the view for on our investors' behalf of what's happening in the market, what's your view on the short term, on the long term, and sectorial views in specific, if you have any. So the mic is all yours, Vinit. Thank you once again for coming to this webinar, and it's all yours. Please go ahead.
So thank you very much, Sampath, and in fact, I would first take this opportunity to thank HDFC Securities for having me here. It's a great feeling to be talking to you investors, and in fact also thank you all the investors who have been patient investors with us for a long period of time. I think you all must have reaped the benefit of having invested us with us through time, and by virtue of my experience in the last 10 years, 8 years of money management, I can only say that the confidence that equity as an asset class tends to deliver phenomenal performance over a longer period of time, that thesis continues to remain intact. So as far as today's talk session goes, what Sampath has asked me about my thoughts on the small and mid cap category, on the markets, what I'm thinking. So let me start by trying to simplify the whole process of or idea of investment, how we think about equity investment, how retail investors should think about equity investment, and really it is talking through my experience of the last 8-9 years of managing money. So as far as the markets are concerned, in the end of the day, what we have realized as a part of the rule book is that it tends to follow the corporate earnings growth, and if we look at long back we go in terms of our own data analysis, we see that typically the overall broader market tends to follow the corporate rate of earnings growth, and if you look at the data last 10 years as well, where the corporate earnings growth has been mediocre. So on a annualized basis, we have done about 6-7% earnings growth in the last 10 years since FY08. The market has also probably delivered similar kind of returns, a large cap. The mid caps have outperformed, but broadly the large caps have delivered similar set of returns. And during this phase, we have seen many events coming and going. We had higher interest rates came off, inflation was higher, inflation came off. We had a political change which was positive for us, yes. And that was one of the biggest positive trigger, but that was phenomenal as far as the market goes. We actually also sailed through the Lehman crisis 2008, and what we have realized is that through time the markets have still tended to follow the earnings, corporate earnings rate of growth. So that's the long-term picture, but this long-term trend has to be also seen frame by frame in terms of how yearly the movement has been. So some year has been low, some year has been high. The important point to tell is that what do we think about the corporate earnings growth for the next 5 years or 7 years?
Absolutely.
So I think, this is trying to just simplify the whole process of how to think about equity investment. And, if we just think now, in terms of the corporate earnings growth, we are pretty enthused that the changes or reforms which were put in process in the last few years, I think those are anyways going to unleash the strong demand momentum for our country. And to just talk about a few, I think we had reforms in terms of GST, which to me is very important here because it really changes the way India conducts their business. And I think most of the companies which are the organized segment is going to gain. The compliance is going to improve. You'll have more and more company coming into the tax bracket. Government finances are going to improve. I think that's a very strong reform which has sort of set in, and now with the e-way bill being introduced, I think it is going to further get fortified in terms of the leakages if any there are. Secondly, you know, this whole infrastructure push which this government has, I think that is also very relevant and very important, because today we have seen that the private sector has been slow in terms of investment, but the government is doing the required push to improve the infrastructure growth. And that is going to lead to a spiral in terms of employment generation, demand creation, and hence we believe that this is again going to be a recurring thesis, recurring process, and that is going to entail significant benefit as far as the corporate earnings growth is concerned. Now, looking at these, reforms, what we feel is that the private sector capex, which is lying low today, should also perk up at some point in time. Okay. The reason being, as the demand momentum improves, as the capacity utilization starts to reach a level where the corporate starts feeling that we need to add more capacities, I think that that's the second phase, whenever it starts. So to us, what we are trying to say, we had a very long stint of a low growth phase since 2008. It was 6 to 7% kind of growth. The corporate profit to GDP ratio has deteriorated from 7-8% to 5-6%, 3-4%, and it's only natural that by law of averages, we should, as the economy starts growing, the corporate earnings growth should start showing that momentum. And I think that will be the biggest trigger, which will anyway overcome if any negative news flows, be it political turmoil, be it the macroeconomic picture, be it the international turmoil. I think those will eventually, the earnings growth will have the power to overcome those. And I think we are then looking at a better scenario.
So I would like to hear that again, Vinit. That's a very interesting statement you said. So the macroeconomics, it certainly seemed to be a concern. So
right.
The corporate earnings will certainly cover that, is what your point you're saying, that to a large extent it might take care.
Definitely. So I think what will happen is that all these negative news flows which we may encounter going ahead, let's say 1 year, people are talking of being very volatile because of the political events which are going to unfold, also the international pressures which are there. But I think the growth, the corporate growth, will have the power to overcome all of these. And when people see growth, I think then people start realizing that, people start assigning higher multiples to the equity as a whole. And hence, we believe that as corporate earning momentum starts, I think these things will be taken care of. I'm not suggesting that it will be a very smooth drive ahead. Volatility is part of the game. I think that is good because it also leads to proper risk assessment of the market. People tend to, in good times, people tend to forget this risk in the equities as well. So to me, as we move ahead, volatility will be there. But I think as corporate growth comes back, we will see the markets also heading in a higher zone.
So I think this is what Vinit, the retail investors today has been expecting us also to give some kind of thoughts in terms of the markets, the macroeconomics piece. If you see the trade wars which was happening day before yesterday, there was a huge last 1 hour selling happened because of the news, sheer news, and then again it bounced off the last 2 days, and today it's flat. So I think what I could gauge from whatever you try to cover up is volatility is something which you need to survive this year. Can we take it that way? Or volatility, could you just add a few more points on volatility? What exactly will be the future? I mean, it's unfair to ask you what exactly will be the future, but will volatility be part of the future? My question maybe.
So anyways, we can also make our best assessment, because we don't know how this trade war is finally going to escalate, how it is going to unfold. Probably if it gets murkier from here, I think we will have this international pressures coming through. I mean, that's part of the that's part of the whole sentiment getting impacted, and volatility in the sense that markets may look at some bit of weakness during that phase. In the next 1 year, we're also facing few state elections and one big national elections, and whatever news flows we will keep reading and the outcome of the state elections will may also have bearing on the market. So the feeling is that, as you said, this 1 year needs to be, you know, where investors need to be exercising patience. Volatility will be part of the game. But what one needs to look at is the corporate rate of earnings growth. And that, if it is showing, you know, signaling the right direction, then I think we should be okay in terms of our equity assets are concerned.
Great, great, Vinit. I think this is what you have been time and again saying in your all your past interactions. I think today you have conveyed the same to our investors as well. Would you like to say a few more thoughts on your what exactly you did to your two schemes during this period? Did you do any significant change in your portfolio? Did you do some asset allocation in various sectors? Did you go high on few and go low on few? Would you like to say, I know I'm throwing a lot of questions to you, but that's what the questions the investors have also thrown to us. You know, what exactly is happening in the banking space, especially in the public sector? What do you think is the pharma looking like? Is that all reflecting in your portfolio as well? Could you just take a few more minutes or 10 minutes on briefing about that?
Sure. So thank you for asking me this question. And before I start answering the questions on the small and mid-cap fund and the portfolio, let me also inform the investors here that the new SEBI regulation has you know, let us carry out few changes. So one is that our small and mid-cap fund is now known as DSP BlackRock Mid-Cap Fund.
Okay, that's DSP Mid-Cap Fund, BlackRock Mid-Cap Fund.
DSP BlackRock Mid-Cap Fund. And the DSP BlackRock Micro-Cap Fund is now known as DSP BlackRock Small-Cap Fund. This is in line with the new SEBI regulations where the definition of the market capitalization and the allocation of the fund has been aligned to the new SEBI requirement. And as far as the mid-cap, DSP BlackRock Mid-Cap Fund is concerned, the set of companies which you know, one can look at is between 101st to 250th company. Those are defined as the mid-cap companies. So that's the universe as far as the mid-cap fund goes. But the mandatory requirement is to have 65% invested into that category. Beyond 65%, we are free to invest into large caps or small caps. Similar is the case for DSP BlackRock Small Cap Fund. Beyond 250th company is all the small cap universe. And as a small cap fund, we have to invest minimum 65% into that category. Beyond 65%, we are free to invest into mid caps.
Any market cap, since small cap is something which is your favorite as well, any market cap specific?
So as of now, it works that the 250th company is roughly about 9,000 crore market cap. So okay, below 9,000 crore is all small caps. Okay. 22,000 crore is the 101st company market cap. So that's the large and mid cap bifurcation. So between 9,000 to 22,000 crore is mid cap, and beyond 20, upward of 22,000 is all large cap. So that's the structure. And now coming specifically to our funds, what we've been doing, I think we have been consistently following the same philosophy, which is trying to identify, you know, companies on a bottom-up basis. Trying to look at businesses which we believe can scale up in the next 4-5 years. Trying to look at the companies where we feel that the management can drive the growth forward. They have the credibility and the capability to drive that growth. Trying to pick our winners across the various categories. And now with the correction which we have seen in the small and mid cap, I'll come to the valuations. We are trying to further consolidate our portfolio. So for all the investors, let me also inform here, when I mentioned consolidation, if we minutely observe our portfolio, in the last 3 odd months, if you look at our top 10 stock weights, that has moved up from, I think, roughly 26-27% to about 30-odd%. What does that mean is, you know, whenever, you know, we see correction happening in our high conviction names, we try and you know, add more to those high conviction names so that whenever the scenario changes, we have meaningful position, we have meaningful exposures across those names so as to benefit out of the recovery process. As far as the fund mix goes today, in the DSP BlackRock Mid-Cap Fund, we roughly have about 55-odd% coverage into the new mid-cap as defined by SEBI. We have to build another about 10-odd% which we'll do shortly. terms of the sectoral mix, I think broadly we try and follow, you know, don't churn a lot. It's a buy and hold approach. It's a long-term holding approach. So what we have been, segments which we have been positive about, you know, last year or year before that, broadly we have stayed focused on those. In terms of the segments, we are bullish on the consumer discretionary category because we believe that consumer discretionary is one where we see India, you know, as a country, the positive demographics, the, you know, rising income level, aspiration level is going to drive the whole consumption trend. So that's something which we are very positive. And we saw post demonetization, you know, quickly the demand momentum picked up. So we didn't take a lot of time even after this big event, which is, you know, demonetization. So as a country, I think we are all consumption driven. So yes, we like the consumer discretionary as a category, and we are playing through our you know, stock, which we found interesting. Beyond that, we are positive about the whole banking and NBFCs. And here I would like to also answer your questions about the PSU banking space, the corporate banking, what's happening. So frankly, as far as the mid-cap fund goes, we do not have exposure in the PSU banking space as of now.
Not even Bank of Baroda?
No. As a fund house, we have exposure, but not
here. At this. Okay.
The only reason is that these companies, these banks are, you know, looking cheap in terms of the valuations. But, you know, my feeling is that you know, the whole cleanup process is still happening. And once, you know, we take a view that we are towards the, you know, end of all this cleaning up process, towards the end of this whole process, then we'll start probably exploring the options of looking at it. We are not negative per se on the whole corporate banking space because of the fact that government has basically in a way compelled these corporate banks to clean up their act. And that's a very positive signal, not just from that specific PSU banking space, but it is also good for us as a country because, you know, that will only open up, you know, once the cleanup act takes place, these banks will be free to start lending. And you know, that's the only way one can look at capex momentum going up. So corporate banks, specifically the PSU banks, we have an you know, our options open. We are looking at the space, not yet invested, but we'll look at it at some point in time. Beyond that, we are positive about the whole industrials and the capex intensive industries, and we are trying to largely play more through the engineering sort of companies. The reason for that is we tend to like the way they conduct the business. We like the cash flow. We like the, you know, focus more on the ROC, the cash flow. So we are trying to play the whole industrial recovery through some of these engineering companies which we own in our portfolio, and also the cement companies. Beyond that, we also have a, you know, since last year we have been adding positions to our healthcare portfolio because our feeling is that in case of pharmaceutical companies, there has been a massive price correction and time correction in the last 2 to 3 years. The companies have seen the US FDA problems hitting them, and some of the companies are towards the fag end of getting their problems resolved.
Okay. So just which are the companies we may ask?
You can look at it from our portfolio. We like to name the companies, but we have those in our portfolio. And there are two set of companies which we are working with. One is these companies which are US oriented companies, looking at the US generics market, but had the but were facing the US FDA plant related issues.
Okay.
Some of them which are getting their acts together, and you know, towards the fag end of getting you know, clearance for their plants, we have looked at some of those companies. And one set of companies are the ones which are focusing on the domestic market, where they have created very strong brands in India, because India as a market continues to remain attractive. 12-13% growth is a given, and companies which does well tend to outperform this growth. So we have looked at a basket of these two set of companies because we felt the valuations were looking good at this point in time. I think broadly, and also specialty chemicals, we have been bullish on the category for a long period of time. We continue to remain bullish because we have seen that these companies, first of people have done good investments in their asset creation for the last 2 years. The benefit of that should flow in now. So we have you know, investment in those. As far as our underweight positions are concerned, on the technology sector, today we are underweight. We are watching the space. We don't yet see a very strong demand momentum coming back, so we are underweight there. And also the telecom utilities is where we are underweight. Broadly, that is how the portfolio mix is structured today.
Okay. Great. I think very fair in-depth analysis you certainly did show. I think we have covered certainly volatility. We have covered your two streams in detail. But the question still remains. How long do I need to be invested? Can 2017 be repeated? Is 2018 going to be as good as 2017? If not as good, will it be half of what 2017 was? How is 2019? Then it's a much more beyond view. But on a, if I may ask on behalf of our investors, on a 3-year scale, on a 3-year horizon, if I have to look at these two schemes, what do you think one investor should, a retail investor should look at these two schemes?
So again, you know, good question from the retail investor's viewpoint, because wherever I go, I keep getting the same question, and I think it is good for me to clarify, and I like clarifying on this part of the question. So one is that if we look at the last 3 months, the correction in the small and mid-cap category, I think the premium which it was trading, that premium has come off slightly. So, you know, our calculation suggests that the small and mid-cap as a category was trading at a roughly 25% premium to the large cap. Now it is down to about 16-odd% premium. So that itself, in a way, is a good starting point, so to say. Can it correct further? Can the gap narrow? It is likely. If there is a sentiment impact on the markets, the small and mid cap definitely will give way, and the premiums can narrow. But my point is that, my conviction on the small and mid cap category tends to remain very high because of the companies where we have investment into. When we look at the outlook of these companies 3 years out, 4 years out, we get very excited that there is, first of all, huge opportunity which these companies can tap, and some of the strategies which these companies have employed make us believe that they will outgrow the category, outgrow the industry. And what that means is that even if the small and mid cap trades at a slight premium to the large cap, that premium may continue because the higher growth will tend to capture that. And you know, over a 3-year period or 4-year period, it will still tend to outperform. So our view on the small and mid cap category overall tends to remain very positive if investor is willing to have a 3 to 4 years time horizon in mind.
Perfect. So on a 3 to 4 years, certainly you don't need to, it would certainly be a good asset allocation product. You don't need to panic, and you don't need to rush everything to the large cap. And if a 3-year, 5-year horizon, I think this should be a very, say,
right,
looking forward. So what is the AM, you know, in fact, has it gone down a bit in terms of the last 2-3 months in this particular schemes, or because you restricted also a couple of investments, what is your view now? Are you planning to take it off, or what is that?
Yes, you're right. We have been facing slight outflows from our small cap scheme, and the mid cap is still okay. We've not faced that any outflows there, redemptions there in a big way. And as far as the opening up of the scheme is concerned, definitely we are open to the option. Only point is that at any point in time in the market, when we feel that a small cap as a category has seen a decent correction, and we have enough opportunities available to deploy money at any point in time, we surely will take a decision to open up the fund for retail investors.
That should be certainly a great news for the retail investors. I think before, just, you know, it's been half an hour since we have been hearing you, so I think the questions are all the same what I have been asking for. So should I continue my SIPs in your schemes? I'm sure you're not going to say no to that. That is the best way to invest. I think that is also some kind of panic that has happened in this space. What, as a distributor, we have also seen, I'm just sharing with you our experience as well. There's some kind of panic selling in terms of closure of SIPs in the mid-cap and small-cap space. I think we don't need to repeat again the kind of conviction you have given in terms of this space. And if a 3-year to 5-year horizon, I don't think investors need to worry that.
Sure.
Absolutely. So that is that point you have made it very clear. Also, Vinit, what is happening now in terms of the balance fund, the kind of people coming into the balance portfolio? Debt is something which is also people are really, you know, has some kind of influence in the equity space as well. It's equally volatile. It's also an area of concern. I think that point also, do you want to just cover upon what's happening on that side as well?
So I think broadly the nature of investors who choose the balance fund is slightly different, where the risk aversion is.
Because the reason why I'm asking you this is, if you see the last couple of years, we have been also positioning your DSP balance
right.
fund also to a large extent. And there has been a huge, you would be aware that there's a huge appetite for the investors in terms of entire AUM that came across. I'm sure you would be tracking the numbers that went predominantly on the
right.
balance as a category. So since debt comes 35-40% there, I'm sure that retail investors would be keen to know on what's happening on that space. As well. You can take 5 minutes on that.
So I think it's okay. The debt part has been volatile in the last 4-5 months. We saw the G-Sec yields going up almost 120
yes.
odd bips.
Yes.
But to me, I don't see the interest rate going up significantly high. We saw yesterday policy framework, you know, we are looking at a benign inflationary environment. So we really don't see, you know, difficult scenario as far as the debt products are concerned. The interest rate should largely remain in that narrow range. So I think balance fund, you know, to the kind of investors it is suited, I think it is, I see no worries there. Equity, anyways, we have a positive long-term view. And if we the inflationary environment is going to remain benign, then I think the debt side also should be okay, bearing these volatile period. But I think broadly we are okay with our balance fund product.
So nothing alarming on that space?
Not really.
Fair. So if I have to ask you, what's your, this one question every fund manager would like to avoid, but I would like to come up on that. What's your favorite sector at this point of time, if I have to ask you? I know I can't ask you favorite company, but I can certainly ask you, which is the favorite sector, because considering these, I know that the earning potential looks really good, as if I have covered you. I think you beautifully explained that, how this can overtake the challenges in the macroeconomics, and also this has a very, very strong run it can give you in a period of 1 or 2 years. I'm sure there should be some kind of a favorite sector, or which is a sector which you are pretty bullish about, if you can give 2-3 sectors.
So yeah, broadly I spoke about the sectors which we are overweight, and we generally tend to remain bullish on the on the set of companies which we have selected within those sectors. But broadly, if you still want to be very precise, I would say that, you know, we are very enthused by this GST as a reform.
Okay.
And we believe that it's going to really have a long-term positive effect on companies which are in the organized category. We see a lot of trade shifting from unorganized to organized, and the beneficiary of these are going to be companies which are within that space. So across categories, we are looking at the set of companies which we believe would benefit out of this trend eventually in the next 2-3 years. So I think that is one. Secondly, we also you know, have seen a very strong wealth creation has taken place in some of the companies where there has been the management change taken place. We have seen the second generation of management coming in those companies and have totally revamped the way in which the business was done. They have come with a thorough knowledge about the business, they have studied well, and have come up with a very positive frame of mind on the governance standard also. They are on a very high pedestal. So
yes.
We have seen a lot of value creation happening there, because, you know, in such cases, what tends to happen is that not only we see earnings growth taking place, but a P re-rating also adds up to the overall return momentum. So we keep eyeing for companies where there are these transformations on the top management, because, you know, eventually in mid-cap space, it is, you know, the top management which is, or for any company really, it's those at the helm of affairs which are, you know, drive the whole you know, growth of the company, and we have seen that happening in many cases. So we get enthused by those, and broadly, as I mentioned, beyond this, the segments which I mentioned, those same old boring segments, they tend to remain. I think India.
So these boring segments continue to excite you, if
yeah.
I can say that way. great way of handling that question, Vinit. I think before my last question towards us, we are coming towards the almost end of this webinar. See, there have been a couple of sectors which we have been growing in the finance space as well. If you've seen, there has not been much of insurance companies which has not been there in the market a year back. Now, you know, you have already three or four there in that space. In terms of asset management company, you know, there are a few more lined up to come. And also there is Reliance which has already come up there in the market and few more to come out there. Similarly, there was never a index called as hospitality or hospitals and healthcare. So do you think something is happening in this space as well in terms of investment products, asset management companies, insurance companies coming in? What do you think about this particular space? Where do you see these companies in the 5 years down the line?
I think they have great future, and it only expands the opportunity size and scale for the equity investors. There are definitely very strong business franchise, and it's a great outlook. India as a country has been under-penetrated in these categories. So, and whole financialization of saving taking place is going to benefit in
this particular
this segment.
So you are pretty bullish about this.
We are pretty bullish. Only as of now, you know, we have to see at what valuation, you know. As long term investors, we tend to remain positive.
That's so nice of you. That was your last question. And once again, on behalf of all our investors and behalf of HDFC Securities, thank you so much for giving our valuable time. And I'm sure that the mid cap and all the whatever portfolio we've been handling should grow many folds, and you should continue creating more wealth for our investors who have been having so much of trust on you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Sampath, and thank you very much all the investors, and hope to see you again.
Sure, we'll do that. Thank you.